Are you ever just grateful for Sweden? For a team that doesn't get a lot, they have given us so much.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits! Left Toronto Maple Leafs. So let me finish. How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped.
With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Wow, you juggled that one.
Balls to the Walgren!
Oh, Brick Walgren. No, we already used Brick Wall for the other guy. We'll work on it!
Steve Dangle here, this is LFR, but before we get cracking, let's talk a little bit about Betway. It's the sports betting app that backs you to trust your instincts. You ever get a sports hunch? You know, like, I think this dude is gonna pitch a 35 safe shutout in his first ever NHL start. You can do that! If that sounds like you, opt into Betway's Parlay Club today to earn $10 worth of free bets. When you place $25 or more on sports multiples or bet builder bets with at least three selections, you'll receive $10 in free bets. This offer is available every week, so head on over to Betway and bet your way. Must be 19 years or older to play, and please play responsibly. Man, I have never seen a goalie controversy end so fast.
Leafs win 4-0 over the Dallas Stars, but
forget all that. Erik Sjallgren, his first NHL start, first NHL shutout, buddy, with the Leaf at the end. It's too good. But it's not just that he made the saves or he got the shutout. We got a lot to talk about with this guy. Let's talk about this game. It's a shame because the broadcast was funny. You could tell they were trying to do the Robertson versus Robertson stuff. Like, they'd been hyping this up for a while and they had obviously recorded some stuff and done some interviews. It's Jason Robertson, this high-flying new NHL star, taking on his brother, Nick Robertson, this young up-and-coming player for the Toronto Maple Leafs. Here's them posing at center ice. Here's their parents. Their mom is the only person in the building with a Leafs jersey and a Stars hat. Also a hat with a name on the side. Can you order those in Leafs? Like, I wanna know. I wanna get a Reimer one for when he comes back. Seriously, I would see that hat and be like, oh, that's their mom. Who else has a hat like that? Seriously, can you order hats like that? It's bugging me now. Kinda want it. Anyway, they were very obviously trying to go with the Robertson versus Robertson angle, and it is very fun, and Nick played a heck of a game. But what do we all want to see? Exactly. Would the kid wilt in net or would he triumph? Erik Sjallgren, the only little bit of NHL hockey we've seen him play was in relief of Peter Mrazek in that game against the Arizona Coyotes. He allowed one goal and picked up the loss in overtime on a goal that probably shouldn't have happened, but refs couldn't be bothered to do anything, literally anything. There was one penalty that game, and it was because the Leafs failed to challenge. That is an automatic penalty. They took the night off, ruining what was otherwise a great NHL debut with a couple really good saves, including a spectacular one in overtime that not only saved the game, but almost got him a secondary assist on the game winner. How good would that have been? Overtime winner, scored by William Nylander, assisted by Austin Matthews and Erik Sjallgren. That almost happened. So here's the thing. Did you know what to expect? I didn't. Because you can look at all the numbers you want, but it's kind of hard to judge a player coming up from the minors until you've seen them. Just based on his numbers, Erik Sjallgren, a 904 in the AHL, oof maroon, not very good. Well, here, I think this should say something. Three goalies have played more than one game for the Toronto Marlies this season, and they are Erik Sjallgren, Joseph Woll, who played with the Leafs earlier this year, and Michael Hutchinson. Sjallgren's played the most games with 26, Woll with 14, Hutchinson with 12. Sjallgren, 904 save percentage, Woll, 902, Hutchinson? 901. So what should that tell you? Well, tells you all the goalies are the same. Well, except Hutchinson has a 5-4-3 record. Woll has a 5-7 record. Sjallgren? 15-8-1. Wins are not a great stat to evaluate goalies, but that's a strange discrepancy. Kind of feels like there's more to the story there, doesn't it? Probably because there is. But we don't get to know the rest of the story until we see him in the show. Opening few minutes, the Leafs not exactly making Sjallgren's job easy. In about the first 13 minutes of the game, the Leafs didn't have a shot on goal. Now, they only gave up 4, and that's not a lot of shots to give up, but you're not going to win the game if you get 0 shots! So that's when Rasmus Sandin decided to say, hey, he's not the only guy playing for a job here. At the beginning of this game, the trade deadline was 3 games away for the Toronto Maple Leafs, and it's less now. Every name is rumored to be going out the door. The Leafs have to rise to the occasion with the first of 2 games without Austin Matthews due to suspension. More Leafs need to have a big game tonight than Erik Sjallgren. Sandin has had some frustrating growing pains, but what a Gronk shift. Flattens one of the stars behind the net and just
gives her.
John Tavares takes the puck up the ice. How is he gonna play with Mitch Marner? That's not his usual winger.
Oh no, how are these two elite forwards who have played together before ever gonna do it?
Tavares just Terminator telekinetically leaves it for Mitch.
Tavares bolts. Mitch heads it to Rasmus Sandin, who has joined the rush now, and obviously he's gonna pass it to JT for the tap-in.
That or he's gonna dangle Jake Oettinger's jock off and backhand it in!
Ooh, woo!
I don't think I'm exaggerating when I say that's the nicest goal of his career. I mean, it's not a lot to choose from, but holy smokes!
Rasmus Sandin, I missed you, sir.
That's a hat pick. Nope. That's the video that I shot earlier today. What do you think, producer Drew? Hat pick?
More likely the shutout, right?
Whatever. It's a really good goal, and now the Leafs are up 1-0.
Little under 4 minutes later, Timothy Liljegren with the puck, quietly having a pretty productive little stretch here.
Before the outdoor game, he had assists in 4 straight games, and he picks up another one here. He's up to 15 points now, and that's his 5th assist in 6 games.
He gives it to Willie Nylander, who puts it on. John Tavares gets positioning on Tyler Seguin, tips it in past everybody, and it's in.
Again, I must ask, what slump?
Tavares, easily the best 91 on the ice in this one, and his 20th goal of the season makes it 2-0 Leafs.
Oh,
Eric, I'm so sorry. They couldn't have left it tied for longer.
Oh my God, this guy's got to defend a lead,
a Leafs lead. How is he gonna overcome this? The Leafs see their own success under the bed and it terrifies them.
Oh no, here they come.
Final seconds of the first, it's a nightmare scenario. John Klingberg just flings it on, it hits a body in front and dies.
Like, it's just sitting there. It's just sitting in this awful no man's land where everyone's got a dance partner and anyone can squirt loose at any moment, and it's a little too far to get to, but maybe if I do, but no, I shouldn't.
Fox it beats Nylander, takes it backhand.
He stopped it. I like him. Play him more.
He'd stop that.
The Stars try to jam it home, but Eric Karlgren, he did his research
on how to best stop the Dallas Stars. No.
On how to best stop Radek Foxa.
No.
You know what he looked up? You know what he researched?
Where the posts are.
Yes. Absolutely yes. That's right there! Good for you! Pin the tail on the post! Love it!
The bar is subterranean, but you soar over it like an eagle!
Probably his best save of the game, wouldn't you say? And the Leafs take a 2-0 lead into the first intermission.
A first intermission where they have a 2-0 lead, and we're outshot 13-10.
And the second period,
no goals, but the Leafs and Stars combined for 31 shots. 18 for the Leafs, another 13 for the Stars.
And Sjogren looks good.
I could do without some of the rebounds.
But generally speaking, he's a lot more calm than either goalie has been for about a month.
And he plays in his net!
Like, literally, stuff is gonna happen. Situations like that John Klingberg shot just dying right there in the slot. That's going to happen. Hey, giving up rebounds is gonna happen, but I tell you what, when things get hairy, when you give up a rebound, when the puck is in danger of going in the net, you know where it's the best place to be? The hottest club in town? The best real estate in the entire city? In the net!
No, not all the way in the net, not so far in that you're knocking the thing off!
In the net. In the blue paint. In between the posts. Roughly evenly. That's it. That's where the bar is, and I saw him standing roughly where a goalie should, and I'm like, good for him! Good! Real good!
So good, in fact, that you might have to play some
we'll cross that bridge when we get there. I really liked about Sjogren's game, and it really helped him in a few instances, and on that big flurry at the end of the first period. He tracks pucks well through traffic. He doesn't do the meerkat. I hate the meerkat. It was the one bone I had to pick with James Reimer. I didn't like the meerkat.
Listen, the Leafs don't need this guy to be the second coming of Patrick Waugh or Dominic Hasek.
They need a goalie who's relatively calm and relatively athletic. He's both.
One complaint through the first 40, the Leafs take 3 penalties,
including another too many men penalty. You gotta stop taking those guys.
But that Leafs penalty kill, real good, and a number of players had really strong games.
Wayne Simmonds was not in the lineup for this one, and I love me some Wayne Train, but that fourth line was humming.
Kyle Clifford getting in the lineup for this one, Spezza at center, Andre Kasha on the right wing feels like an unfair advantage.
Man, the fourth line looks great. Yeah, it's because it's a guy who's very not a fourth fourth liner is on it. Kasha, I would trust Kasha to play on any of the four lines. I would trust him to play defense. I would. If Shalgren was bad in this game, he was going to be next up in net. Sandin obviously had a great game. Despite the first period penalty, Labushkin laying the LaBoom down on Jason Robertson. LaBoom? We'll work on it. I want another shot at that. Can't force it now. I gotta wait for the next time. I want another shot. I'm gonna come back. Labushkin with Riley, and I know on paper it doesn't work at all, but until it stops working on the ice, I think you should keep doing it. Now, to begin the third period, luckily the Leafs begin the third period on the power play because Michael Bunting drew a penalty at the end of the second. Marner, assist number 41, feeds it to Morgan Riley, assist number 41, who feeds it into the slot for Andrzej Kasha. I love that guy's energy. He wants that thing. He wants it so he can get rid of it. He one-times that hot potato pass Ottinger. The Leafs are up 3-0. Oh, I feel so bad for Shalgren. It works in reverse for the Leafs. A 3-0 lead is worse than two. And this, to me, this is where the Leafs played their best hockey. In a period where the Stars were losing the entire time, the whole time, 2-0 to begin, 3-0 for most of it, the Leafs outshoot the Stars 12-9. No breakaways, none of these dumb two-on-ones, none of these, there was one 3-on-2, I think, that didn't really turn into anything. Forwards were coming back and supporting the D. The D were actually moving bodies. This team is so bizarre, man. If you just convince this team they suck, or they're up against it, or they're the underdog, they give these performances. I don't know what it is. Sheldon Keefe needs to, like, do a really good job, a thorough evaluation of this team, and figure out where this team's mind is at when they play these types of games. You know what types of games I'm talking about. Like, they don't play this game every game. Let's be honest. Outdoor game aside, we're not going to talk about that. The Coyotes, they didn't play this game. They just play this lockdown, responsible style, and they don't really sacrifice much up front. Dude, Joseph Woll and Erik Shalgren have started a combined 5 games for the Leafs this season. 2 of them were shutouts! Hutchinson played this season? When? What were his numbers? How don't I remember Wow, he was bad. Oh, okay, sure. Well, they didn't play those games for him, did they? Except they have in the past. They have these strange moments of clarity where they're like, we're gonna be a disciplined, good team. Where the goalie gives them some saves, but they also don't give the goalie a ton to save. Yeah, he ended up making 35 saves, but not a ton of them were dangerous. Now, part of the reason a lot of those shots that Shalgren faced didn't look that dangerous is because he didn't make a save and immediately kick the puck right back to them. Sorry, I'm bitter. But you have to start him next game. You have to. And you probably got to play him Saturday too. Kyle Dubas has until Monday to make a decision here when it comes to goaltending. And a 35 save shutout against a team desperate for points in the standings like the Dallas Stars. I'm sorry. Like, I know it's a small sample size. That has to give you pause. It has to. Besides, if he does great, then you can spend more on other stuff. Questions. Going into this game, the prospect of a Matthews-less team was pretty scary, but they did really well without him. What did you think of the team's performance overall? They do tend to find this weird way to rally, and it's funny because, like, some people are going to look at it like it pokes holes in the idea that Matthews is good defensively. It doesn't. It's not that the Leafs don't have Austin Matthews. It's that they play like a team that's going, oh, we don't have Austin Matthews. Now, 31 out of 32 teams in this league don't have Austin Matthews, but for the Leafs, it's especially alarming because he plays for the Leafs! Give Keefe credit. I thought he did a great job rolling the lines, and the lines did a great job elevating everyone else. If Matthews in the lineup, you can have a couple lines that aren't going at all. You can afford for a few players to be having bad games. You could probably still snore your way to a joke win. Without Austin Matthews in the lineup, you can't have a bad night. And they didn't. Were the Leafs markedly better as a whole tonight, or did they just need competent goaltending to make everyone look better? So this wasn't a game that's like some of the games that Jack Campbell gave the Leafs earlier in the season where you go, oh man, the Leafs are playing great. And then you rewatch the highlights and you're like, oh, without Jack Campbell, this is an 8-7 game. Like, there's a reason Jack Campbell made the All-Star team. He was unbelievable for the Leafs for a stretch. To give you an idea of how unbelievable he was at the beginning of the season, you know how awful his numbers have been since, like, December something or January 1st? Jack Campbell still has a .914 save percentage. That's how good he was. But to me, except for the one scenario at the end of the first, and this was a big and timely save, I didn't think Shulgren had to bail the Leafs out that hard. And I thought the Leafs, the more they trusted him, the better they played, because they knew they didn't have to babysit the guy. So you show me a calm and poised goalie, I'll show you a calm and poised defense. Thoughts on how Tavares fit with Bunting and Marner? Maybe give the line a try even when Matthews is back. Yeah, that's interesting. There's something there. There could be something there. Because look, Bunting, Matthews, Marner, clearly one of the best lines in the league, but the second line is so ineffective that it just doesn't work. I wouldn't split up Matthews and Bunting, though. They got something special going on. I'm sick of the Willie at left wing experiment. I don't like it. So I would say Bunting, Matthews, Willie on the right wing, and we'll see how he does there. Then, Marner, Tavares, and then who do you put with them? You could put Kerfoot as long as you give him the strict instructions, hey, you have to shoot more. But I kind of think they need a worker bee there, and Mikheyev's not it. So I would say Kasha. Give Kasha a shot on the left. So you have Bunting, Matthews, Nylander, Kasha, Tavares, Marner. I'd try that. Seems like deja vu, but there was only one other Leaf who recorded a shutout in his debut start, and that was Garrett Sparks. With the seemingly endless supply of fresh, new Leaf goalies, could this become a habit? First of all, a lot of people liked to point that out. Hey, well, Garrett Sparks did this, so calm down. Okay, yeah, he did do that, and that was a great moment in a not good time for the Leafs. But the reason I suggested that perhaps Peter Mrazek could play with bungee cords to help him know where the net is because I know the Leafs still have the bungee cords left over from when they had Garrett Sparks. Shulgren didn't play like that, man. He stayed in his net and was steady. It was nice. As for could it be habit, I hope so. I'm still a believer in Wool. I hope he gets better. They got some real good guys over in Europe right now, Peksa and Akhtyamov. The Leafs are in such a weird space right now, man. They really are, because help is on the way. Help is on the way. In such a must-win year, help is on the way. But they, without very many picks, have drafted well. They got guys coming. Will it sync up with this season? Rumors of Abruzzese and potentially Matthew Nyes getting a shot with this roster this season. Robertson's finally getting an NHL shot without getting hurt. The goalie prospects are projecting to be a little bit later, but Erik Shulgren might have just sped that schedule up. So that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell your friends. There is no controversy. It's him.